Well, good morning, everyone. It's wonderful to see you here today in the house of the Lord. Welcome to Genesis United Methodist Church. I'm Amber Massengill, one of your co-pastors here. And I would also like to give a special welcome to those who might be worshiping with us online, either live or maybe watching a replay later. We are glad that you have joined us as well virtually. For those of you who are here today, let me give you a couple of announcements as well as instructions. We would love to get to know you better, especially if you are visiting with us. We have a visitor table out here and with just a little gift bag for you, and would love to stay in touch with you. If you could fill out the QR code or the visitor card, that would be wonderful. If you are making a gift today, your offering in person, we have our baskets in the back. You can also give online. You can even text us and with that gift. We have online giving through our website, so we thank you for all of the ways that you give, including your service. I want to welcome the young people who are here with us today and remind you that Children's Church is dismissed during the first hymn. So if you would like to go to Children's Church, you can meet our teachers in the back during the first hymn. We also have our nursery available and worship bags in the back, as well as our wiggle room right over here. So we're glad that our families and young people are here. Okay, just a couple of things coming up this week. First of all, out in our atrium, you'll notice some tables. We have our men's retreat sign up. We also have our United Community Center's snack packs. And we are still looking for some supplies. And there is a list. Or you can give a monetary donation. You can do that online or through your regular giving, so Troy can go and buy snacks. We still have two more weeks of snack packs to provide for the United Community Centers this summer. Next Sunday is Dawson's last Sunday with us, and we have so enjoyed him this summer and really pray that this experience has been a blessing to him as well. Next week, he is going to be preaching again in the morning service. I know that you all are going to get a good word from him. And then in the evening, we're going to have a special potluck dinner after the modern worship service as a celebration and a send-off for him next week. So I invite you to come to both of those and find a way for yourself to say thank you and God bless you to Dawson as he leaves for back to college. That's all of our announcements for this morning. And so with that, I'm going to segue and invite Dawson to come up, and he is going to lead us in our call to worship this morning.
Please rise for the call to worship as we center our hearts and minds on the Lord. Answer me when I call to you, O my righteous God. Many are asking, who can show us any good? You have filled my heart with great joy. Let the light of your face shine upon us. Please remain standing for our opening hymn, and for those of you young people with us, if you want to go to the back, and you are dismissed for Children's Church.
The song is Shine, Jesus, Shine. Sing out. Lord, the light of your love is shining in the midst of the darkness, shining. Jesus, light of the world, shine upon us. Set us free by the truth you now bring us. Shine on me. Shine on me. Shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory. Blaze, Spirit, blaze. Set our hearts on fire. Flow, river, flow. Flood the nations with grace and mercy. Send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. Lord, I come to your awesome presence, from the shadows into your radiance. By the blood I may enter your brightness. Search me, try me, consume all my darkness. Shine on me, shine on me. Sing out, shine, Jesus, shine. With the Father's glory, blaze, Spirit, blaze. Set our hearts on fire. Flow, river, flow. Flood the nations with grace and mercy. Send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. As we gaze on your kingly brightness, so our faces display your likeness, ever changing from glory to glory. Mirrored here, may our lives tell your story. Shine on me, shine on me. Shine, Jesus, shine.
You may be seated. We come now to the time in our service when we go to the Lord our God in prayer. We don't go to the Lord because he is unaware of the things that are going on in our own hearts, in our own families, in our cities, in our state, in our country, and in our world, but we go to the Lord because he calls us to him. He calls us into relationship. He wants to hear from us. He wants us to call out to him in ways when we need help, when we need mercy, when we need grace, when we need restoration, when we need light in our world. And so I would invite you to pray with me. And throughout the prayer, we do a call and response prayer. And so I will at certain points say, Lord, in your mercy, and I invite you to respond with, hear our prayer. Would you pray with me? Holy and triune God of the universe, we thank you so much that we can gather in this space to proclaim that you are the light. Shine, Jesus, shine. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to bring hymns of praise and worship to make a joyful noise unto you this morning, Lord, that we would be set on fire once again for you, that the Spirit would blaze in our hearts. Lord, make it so. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. But Lord, as we enter this space, we recognize that we live in a world where there is darkness. Lord, we see darkness within our own hearts in ways where we have turned from you, our light, and turned back towards darkness. We see darkness in our families, in our communities, in our wider state, in our cities, in our country, and in our world. And Lord, we know that you are needed in those spaces to bring grace and restoration and healing and forgiveness and mercy and joy. So Lord, we ask that you would light up those spaces of darkness within us and within our world. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we want to lift up all of those who are struggling right now. Lord, we lift up those who are currently fighting the fires here in Texas, at Possum Kingdom Lake and elsewhere, and those who have lost their homes in these fires and are dealing with the absolute devastation that they must just be feeling in their hearts and souls right now. Lord, would you comfort them? Would you console them? Would you keep those who are fighting all of those fires safe? Lord, just protect them. Lord, we pray for moisture. We need it, Lord. We ask that with your mighty hand, with your loving gaze, that you would send rain upon our land. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Finally, Lord, as we come here today, we are so thankful and gracious for the gift of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who came into this world of darkness and sin and death and decay and offered light and told us that he is the light of the world. Lord, we thank you for him, for what he has done on our behalf. May we choose to follow him each and every day, and may we pray the prayer he taught his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We have two scripture readings today, and so I'll be doing the first scripture passage now, and then I believe Amber is going to do the second passage when she comes up to deliver her message. So if you want to grab a pew Bible, or if you just want to listen, either one is welcome. But we are going to be reading from the prophet Isaiah, chapter 60, verses 1 through 5, and then skipping down a little bit to verses 18 and 22. And so I would invite you at this time to hear these words of the Lord as if for the first time. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. For darkness shall cover the earth, and thick darkness the peoples. But the Lord will arise upon you, and his glory will appear over you. Nations shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawn. Lift up your eyes and look around. They all gather together. They come to you. Your sons shall come from far away, and your daughters shall be carried in their nurses' arms. Then you shall see and be radiant. Your heart shall thrill and rejoice because of the abundance of the sea shall be brought to you. The wealth of the nations shall come to you. Violence shall no more be heard in your land, devastation or destruction within your borders. You shall call your walls salvations and your gates praise. The sun shall no longer be your light by day, for not the brightness shall the moon give light to you by night, but the Lord will be your everlasting light, and your God will be your glory. Your sun shall no more go down, or your moon withdraw itself, for the Lord will be your everlasting light, and your days of mourning shall be ended. Your people shall all be righteous. They shall possess the land forever. They are the shoot that I planted, the work of my hands, so that I might be glorified. The least of them shall become a clan, and the smallest one a mighty nation. I am the Lord. In this time, I will accomplish it quickly. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Marie and Kim and others for filling in. And Robin's gone, but we always enjoy your music. Thank you. As we come to our gospel lesson for today, the I-N statement for today, you might have caught the theme already, is light. And we're going to be reading from John chapter 9. But would you please join with me in our prayer for illumination before I read the scripture? Let us pray. Open our hearts, Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word is proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us this day. Amen. So the I am statement for today is I am the light of the world that Jesus says. And he says this in the midst of another miracle. We had the feeding of the 5,000, and this is a man who is born blind, receives his sight. So hear these words. It says, as Jesus walked along, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Jesus answered, neither this man nor his parents sinned. He was born blind so that God's works might be revealed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. When he had said this, he spat on the ground and made mud with the saliva and spread the mud on the man's eyes, saying to him, go wash in the pool of Siloam, which means sent. Then he went and washed and came back and was able to see. The neighbors and those who had seen him before as a beggar began to ask, is this not the man who used to sit and beg? Some were saying it is he, others were saying no, but it's someone who looks like him. But he kept saying, I am the man. But they kept asking him, then how were your eyes opened? And he answered, the man called Jesus made mud and spread it on my eyes and said to me, go to Siloam and wash. And I went and washed and received my sight. They said, where is he? And he said, I don't know. And that ends our, I don't think there's another, does it keep going? I think that's the last one. So this is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. So we are going to be talking today some about light and darkness. And I got to thinking about this with our recent trip to Alaska. And I know at this point, if you still ask me how was the trip to Alaska, and Patricia Graysick, you asked me how was the trip to Alaska this morning, so that means I can tell another Alaska story. Okay, great. Just get that clear. Okay, so here's a question for you. Raise your hand if you get anxious going through tunnels, like in a car. Tunnels. I see one, two, three, four hands. Okay. If I'd asked bridges, what would that be? More hands? I don't know. Most people get pretty anxious going through tunnels, and we went through a tunnel in Alaska that had us all a little bit nervous. Some of you might have been there before. It was the Whittier Tunnel. This is a special tunnel that they built to go to the town of Whittier. It is the only way in and out of the town except by boat or by airplane. So if you're in a car or if you're on one of the trains doing a tour, you have to go through this tunnel. And one of the special things about this tunnel is that it is a one-way tunnel. It is a single lane. It is of road and of railroad track. It is such a popular destination, Whittier is, and this tunnel, that they have to have a rotation of traffic. And so you have 15 minutes. And traffic goes towards the town. And then traffic, 15 more minutes, comes back out of town. And then they switch to the trains, and the trains do the same thing. So there was a 15-minute window, and we show up at minute 14 and 30 seconds. I don't know really what time it was, but we were the last car that they let into the tunnel. And when we first went into the tunnel, and you're driving on this single lane and it's on the rail track, and there was no other cars there. It was just us in this tunnel. Like, there was lights, of course, there was electricity, but we couldn't see anything in front of us, we couldn't see anything behind us. This was about a 2.5, 2.5 mile tunnel. And we were all nervous. I'm actually nervous, just like I'm anxious just even thinking about it. We kept looking behind us or in front of us, like expecting, you know, that they were going to somehow, I don't know, lose track of time and start reversing the traffic, or a train was going to come up behind us, or however it is that they worked this system. Well, needless to say, in just a few minutes, we made it to the other side of the tunnel. Later, I was thinking about this, and it was actually not the most intimidating tunnel I have ever been through. We lived in England back in the year 2000, right after we got married, and we took a trip over to Paris, and we took the tunnel to get there. Has anybody ever been on the tunnel? Okay, so a few of you. That was also a nerve-wracking tunnel to go through. Am I raising anxiety just talking about this? I don't know. So a lot of people aren't aware that in 1994, the longest underground tunnel was built, connecting going from London to Paris underneath the English Channel. And it's called the Channel. And you take the train there. And it's a 31-mile tunnel, but for about 23 and a half miles, you're actually underwater. You're actually underwater in this train, in this tunnel. And that's enough time for your imagination to kind of go wild. You know, and it starts like in your mind's eye, you think, well, what if there's a little hairline crack, you know, in the concrete? And then you start imagining water shooting through. You guys you're like tough as steel over here. Like, nobody's hyperventilating yet. I'm really getting like a knot in my stomach, just reliving it. Well, we were chatting with friends. We were going with them to Paris, and so the time went by. But needless to say, as we got to the other end, and I saw the light at the end of the tunnel, that small pinprick of light get larger and larger, I was so eager, I was so relieved, because I knew soon I would see the sky again. And once we did emerge and we came up on the landscape, it was beautiful. It was a beautiful French countryside that we got to ride through. And it definitely seemed like it was worth it, getting through to the other side. But I think about those tunnels, the one that I went through recently and the one from years ago, as we come to this text today where Jesus says, I am the light of the world. And I think of this saying that we have that is a common saying that I know will mean something to you, the light at the end of the tunnel. The light at the end of the tunnel. Now, maybe it is sort of that visceral, you know, physical reaction that you have after me telling about going through these stressful tunnels. But maybe it's not a real physical tunnel, you know. But you know what that saying means, light at the end of the tunnel. We can picture it in our mind. You can picture probably right now a dark space. Right, and that pinprick of light. And that tunnel in your mind's eye, it could be 2.5 miles long or 23 and a half miles long. But you can picture it, the light at the end of the tunnel. And we use that saying to describe going through difficult, arduous times of our lives, times of despair. And even hopelessness. But the light at the end of the tunnel is the hope that it will be over soon. Amen? It will be over soon. And you know that on some level, right? That there is always light at the end of the tunnel. We use that saying, the light at the end of the tunnel, in lots of different ways. Teachers and students use it to talk about the last day of school, you know, when you turn over the calendar and circle that last day, that's the light at the end of the tunnel of a long academic year. Maybe parents are thinking that about right now, about the first day of school and sending their kids back after the summer. It's a patient battling cancer and coming to the last round of chemotherapy. The light at the end of the tunnel. It's when you get down to your last mortgage payment or the last credit card payment and you see the light at the end of the tunnel. You might have used that saying recently for something that you're going through. Some difficult time, some challenging experience, some season of despair or sorrow. And you know what that light represents at the end of the tunnel. It represents relief, freedom, peace of mind, excitement even, gratitude. But again, most of all, it represents hope that it will be over soon. Light at the end of the tunnel was not something that the blind man in our gospel lesson knew. He never knew light at the end of the tunnel. Of course, he did not know that because he had never seen light. He had been born blind from birth. So he couldn't imagine what, of course, light at the end of the tunnel would mean. He is at least a young adult at this point. His parents later in verse 23 describe him as of age. And so he probably didn't even have hope that he would ever see light. Maybe there had been a time when he was young in his childhood when they thought maybe the sight would come to him and would be returned to him. But after however many years or decades to be of age, his sight had never come. So hope or light at the end of the tunnel was not something he ever knew. But there was more to it than that. There was more to his darkness than his lack of sight. This man was trapped in the stigma and the shame that came with being afflicted, with having this affliction of blindness. Our story in John 9 opens with the disciples asking a question that tells us about this stigma and this shame that this man was trapped in. The disciples ask Jesus, "Who sinned that this man was born blind, him or his parents?" See, Jewish theology had evolved to the point where they made almost this cause and effect relationship between one's health and success and one's righteousness or sin. In other words, people who broke the Jewish laws, they got sick and they had hardship. And vice versa, those who got sick and had hardship, they must have broken God's law. See the cause and the effect there? If something's wrong with you, that means you did something wrong. We see this theology very clearly in the book of Job. If you're familiar with the book of Job, he's a very righteous man who lost everything. His family, his home, his health, his friends. He had three friends left. They hounded him, asking him, "What did you do wrong, Job?" This is a question they kept asking him. What did you do wrong? Because you must have done something really wrong for all this bad to happen in your life. But Job kept maintaining. He was innocent. He was righteous. He kept all of God's law. He loved the Lord. He didn't know why this was happening, and he would ask God one day if he saw him face to face. And the rest of the story is that he does get to ask that of God. Perhaps this kind of theology went all the way back to the giving of the law in the book of Exodus, where God makes a covenant with Moses and the people, and God says, follow these commandments and it'll go well with you and you will be blessed. Don't follow them and it won't go well for you. But instead of taking this as sort of a general condition of the covenant, the Jews turned it into sort of a superstitious formula for life. Like, don't step on a crack or you're going to break your mother's back. Right? Don't break God's law or someone in your family may get really sick. Either way, the point is that this young man that we meet in John chapter 9, he is doomed in this dark space where he has no sight. And he is labeled a sinner, and his family has done something wrong because he is afflicted so. Not only can the blessing of God go on for generations, but the curse can too. And so really, there was no way out for this family and for this young man. There was no light at the end of the tunnel. But in walks Jesus, right? And he says, I am the light of the world. This man who has been in darkness his whole life will see light for the first time. And that was literal. He would see light, he would regain his sight, and he would also see an end to this stigma. The metaphor of light and darkness is really clever, brilliant even, right? And it's not just this one man's light who had come, but as Isaiah 60 tells us, the light had come to all of us, to all who walk in darkness. John, the gospel writer, he loved this metaphor of light and darkness. He even started his gospel there, those very first words in John chapter 1. He said, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. In other words, remember, I am. And through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not overcome it. Jesus is the light of the world. He is the light at the end of the tunnel. For you, for your family, for the generation, for all generations. And we need it so badly. Yes, there is darkness in each one of us that exists within us, and there is darkness in our world, places where God's presence doesn't seem to be. I would say that God's presence is everywhere, but it doesn't seem to be. We can't see God's presence in those places. And so we need Christ, the light of the world. We need Christ, the light of the world, because we create these small spaces for ourselves, these small dark places. The Jewish leaders had created it. The Pharisees had created it. And this man and his family lived in that, where keeping the letter of the law was more important than anything else. This healing, we didn't read this, but the healing actually happened on the Sabbath day. It says in verse 14. Now, you may know this, maybe you don't, but they were forbidden to do work on the Sabbath, and they were forbidden to even help their neighbor on the Sabbath. And Jesus took argument with this. He said, you know, if your donkey falls into a hole, like you can't even pull him out, and you can't even feed one another, when you're hungry on the Sabbath? Is keeping the letter of the law more important than loving your neighbor and caring for others? And so guess what Jesus did? He healed on the Sabbath. And he fed others and himself on the Sabbath. Because he was the light at the end of the tunnel. This long, dark tunnel where they were constrained and trapped by the letter of the law. But here comes Jesus, the grace of God, the love of God in the flesh, the light at the end of the tunnel, that system would be over soon. That system of sacrifice and earning your righteousness, that would be over. He was the light at the end of the tunnel. Jesus overcomes this darkness, my friends, for you and me and for the whole world, this cycle of judgment and shame that so many people still live in, that so many people still think today, why is this bad thing happening in my life? What did I do wrong? I know that you know people who think this way, and you might have even thought this way. That because you suffer, because there is tragedy, because you're afflicted in some way, did you do something wrong? Friends, Christ is the light. He is the grace at the end of that tunnel. That mindset, that thinking, that theology, we are not meant to live in that space. We are invited out into the great wide open of God's grace where we have freedom in his grace. Not freedom to sin, freedom to love and to live and to serve others, just as Christ did. This man receives the gift of a physical sight, but he also receives the gift of faith. By the end of the story, it goes on, verse 38, he confesses his belief in Jesus and he worships him, knowing that Christ alone is the light at the end of our tunnels. As I said, we all have that darkness within each one of us and all around us. Some of that darkness that we're trapped in is our own doing, my friends. It's our own sin and disobedience. Some of it is part of our broken and tragic world, the oppressive and evil forces that do surround us. And some of that darkness is just a part of what it means to be uniquely human, that with our joy and with our love, then there also is sorrow and sadness. And we can feel both in great ways. That is, chances are good that you have spent time in some of these dark places and you have loved ones too. And you wonder, will this go on forever? Will this ever end? And I want you to hear the good news that Christ is the light of the world. He has come to bring light into your darkness and into the world. It is so hard when you watch a loved one in a downward spiral. It is so hard when we keep reading the same tragic headlines over and over again. It is hard when you just start to process the grief of losing a loved one or something precious to you and you wonder, is this going to last forever? This grief? And God's answer to that, God's response is to that is look to Christ, your light. And sometimes there's a miracle in Christ's light when we least expect it but need it the most. And sometimes God just shakes us up and helps us see again, to see his grace at work around us. I remember a time a number of years ago, we had already moved to Fort Worth, which, you know, was moving halfway across the country and starting all over again. And we had gone through some medical things for the boys, and they had gotten new schools, and we started these new jobs. Then I went through some medical things, and it just had built up over the years. I mean, it probably about over about 3 years' time. And I went to a retreat with some clergy and laity, and it just burst, you know, and I just started crying, and I couldn't stop crying, and I cried, I think, the whole retreat. I'm not even sure what it was about, what they said. But we ended with a healing service where they invited us to come for prayer. And so the retreat leaders, I went forward, and I had them pray with me and pray over me, laying on of hands, and I just cried and I cried. But for the first time, I felt relief and peace. For Christ was the light at the end of my tunnel. And it doesn't mean that things have been, you know, perfect and rosy ever since. I mean, we've had this thing called the pandemic that we've all gone through, and we wonder, is this ever going to end? Where is the light at the end of this tunnel? And friends, it is the grace of Jesus Christ, just like it is for the illnesses we go through and the traumas that our family goes through and the moves and the changes. Christ is the light at the end of our tunnel. You may be going through something right now, and I want to invite you, if you need prayer, ask one of us, ask Paul or I, ask one of your friends, let us pray with you. Let us share the light of Christ with you. You're here today maybe because you went through the 6 days of the week, and you're like, I need some light at the end of this tunnel, and that's going to be in worship, praising God, my Savior, all the day long. But friends, I also want to give you something else to think about as the church, as we gather here today. Jesus said these words. He said, while I am in the world, I am the light of the world. And Jesus is that light. He will always be that light. He was there in the beginning. God said, let there be light. And the prophets foretold this glory that would come. Arise, your light has come. But Jesus is no longer physically in the world. His body, he is no longer here. And he told his disciples in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 5, guess what, my friends? You are the light of the world. Because we carry Christ into the world. This is our ministry now as the church, as the followers of Christ. It is no longer the role of God's people to create these small places for people to live. You know, following the letter of the law, you know, to where they feel suffocated by it. No, our ministry is to share the light of Christ, the grace, the freedom for all people, and to take this light into those places of darkness. Friends, to whatever people you know, whatever situations you're aware of, those who feel like this affliction, whatever that is never going to end, you are invited to tell them that Christ is coming, that God's grace is coming, and in fact, not only is it coming, look, here it is. Christ is here. And we, the church, are the light of the world. God help us, and God give us faith to hang on for Christ is right there with us. Let us pray. God, we thank you so much for this word of hope. Lord, we are not alone. It is not ours to fix this world, Lord God, but you came into the world that they may know you and your Son, Jesus. Lord, we pray that as we carry the light from this place, that we would know it for ourselves. God, that whatever we're going through right now, Lord, that you are there with us. We are not in this darkness, God, but we have hope. Lord, that we are loved, that we have a purpose, that we will see you face to face. God, and that this sin and this darkness will be redeemed. We pray, oh God, that you would give us sight, Lord, that you will give us spiritual eyes to see this, God, that darkness does not have the last word. Indeed, darkness did not overcome the light, but your light has overcome the world. We pray for all the ways that we can share that, Lord, here on site, God, with the people who come to our church throughout the week and all the places that we take the church out into the world. Lord, we pray that you would go with us and that you would shine on us and shine through us. We pray this through your Holy Spirit in your Son's name. Amen.
And if you could stand and join in singing, Be Thou My Vision, and we'll sing all three stanzas.
Arise, church, for your light has come. Christ has come. He is the light of the world. Just as we take the light from the candles out in the world, you are invited to take the joy and grace and love of God out with you today. Go in peace. Amen.
I want to walk as a child of the light. Join me in singing our benediction.
I want to walk as a child of the light. I want to follow Jesus. time.